In the first video, entitled What is Fugacity? Single component fugacity is discussed. And in this video, we will consider multi-component by looking at a two-component system. So consider two phases, an alpha phase and a beta phase, and the mole fractions of component 1 and 2, so it's a binary mixture. Component 1 and 2 in the alpha phase and the beta phase are given, and the mole fractions are different. And so the question is, since this system is assumed to not be at equilibrium, what is the direction of mass transfer? Does component 1 move in this direction, or does it move in this direction? And how do we determine that? So the fact that the mole fractions are not equal is not enough to tell us whether or not it's in equilibrium. The mole fractions are not going to be the same in equilibrium. What determines the direction of mass transfer is the chemical potential of component 1 in the alpha phase and the beta phase. If the chemical potential in the alpha phase is greater than in the beta phase, then component 1 is going to move from the alpha phase to the beta phase. Other way of stating that is that the fugacity in the alpha phase is greater than the fugacity in the beta phase, then component 1 moves from the alpha phase to the beta phase. And the fugacity notation that's used in a number of textbooks for mixtures puts a small hat over the fugacity term. So the question then becomes, how do we determine the fugacity? So, if we look at the case of an ideal gas, one of the simpler cases, let's look at this system and let's assume that this is actually a gas phase and this is a liquid phase, and we want to determine equilibrium between gas and liquid, which is a common situation when we're looking at separations. So, we'll assume the gas phase is an ideal gas. So, it's an ideal gas mixture. And we want the fugacity then of component 1 in the alpha phase, the gas phase. Well, it's going to be equal to the mole fraction of component 1 in the alpha phase times the total pressure. Or the more normal notation we might use is the mole fraction for a gas is Y times the total pressure. So this is the partial pressure. So fugacity, ideal gas, fugacity of a given component. So we can do the same in the alpha phase. Component 2 is Y2 times the pressure, partial pressure component 2. So for this system, of course, then fugacity component 1 in that alpha phase and the vapor phase would be equal to 2.7 times the total pressure. Notice that the units of fugacity are the units of pressure. Now we're assuming then that the beta phase is a liquid phase. And we'll look at the simplest case for the liquid phase of an ideal solution. And for an ideal solution, we calculate the fugacity relative to the saturation pressure for the pure component. So component 1 in the beta phase is the liquid phase in this case. So the mole fraction of component 1 in the beta phase, the liquid phase, times the saturation pressure of component 1. Right, so this would be, this case, 0.4 times the saturation pressure. If they were at equilibrium, then we would expect the fugacity in the alpha phase for component 1 would be equal to fugacity in the beta phase for component 1. And so that means that the mole fraction in the gas phase for component 1, that's the alpha phase, times the total pressure is equal to mole fraction in the liquid phase, beta phase, times the saturation pressure component 1. And this is Raoult's law, which is ideal solution and ideal gas. And so in our system, mass transfer is going to occur either component 1 going from the beta phase to the alpha phase, or component 1 going from the alpha to the beta, until we get to equilibrium as defined by this criteria here. So both X1 and Y1 could change. For doing this at fixed pressure and fixed temperature, which means Psat is also a constant. If we don't have an ideal liquid solution, in other words, the interactions between the components are different than just some average interaction, and certainly that's a reasonably common occurrence. Then component one, fugacity in the beta phase, and let me just make it clear that's the liquid phase, would be x1 times gamma 1 times p1 sat. So this gamma is basically a correction. It's referred to as the activity coefficient, and it's correcting for the fact that we don't have an ideal solution. We need some information about the interactions in order to be able to calculate this. So if we just look now in general of how changing variables affects fugacity in a mixture, if we raise the pressure, well, for the gas phase, the relation is clear. The fugacity of component one in a vapor phase is the mole fraction times the pressure. Again, this is ideal gas. And so as we raise the pressure, we're going to raise fugacity. For the liquid phase, as we raise the pressure, it's not so clear. And it's going to be the same type behavior that we saw fugacity for single component. It's fugacity at saturation for the liquid times the exponent of the pressure above the saturation pressure times RT and times the molar volume. Fugacity of component one at saturation conditions. That's the pure component. And then for the ideal solution that we're looking at, at saturation pressure, and this is a very small correction. So it's going to be very close to our original value of, it's approximately X1, P1 sat. But this is a small correction, only it's going to become important at high pressures, for example, the high pressures that are used in reverse osmosis to purify salt water. If we look at a mixture, what happens as we raise the temperature? Well, for liquid phase, saturation pressure goes up as the temperature goes up, and therefore the fugacity will increase as we raise the temperature. And so we raise the mole fraction. So X1 increases, then the fugacity in general is also going to increase. So we increase the concentration, we tend to increase the fugacity. Keep in mind this is increasing the mole fraction. Increasing the amount of a phase does not increase fugacity, right? This fugacity, like many of the variables we look at, are intensive variables. So if we had two systems, liquid and vapor, where we had very different amounts of liquid and vapor, and we were at equilibrium, X1 is 0.4, here X1 is 0.4, the vapor, and let's say equilibrium is 0.65. Well, then at equilibrium, this would be 0.65. The amounts of the phases are not important. The concentrations, which are, of course, related to mole fractions, are important.